So, the subject of today's conference is the private sector turn, is the move in development finance from public support to developing countries to private sector interests in developing countries. And that's been a very noticeable transition throughout this last decade. In 2000, out of total multilateral development bank portfolios, 90% went to public sources and only 10% to private. By 2007, the proportions were well on their way to being inverted. It was 60% to the private sector and only 30% to the public. Now that trend has been slightly blipped by the financial crisis and the bailouts to developing country governments, but that trend is very much the direction in which we're moving. The real drivers behind that transition are the IFC, the private sector arm of the World Bank, which has nearly quintupled its lending over the course of the decade, and the European Investment Bank, which has tripled its lending outside the EU and is now in sectors like fossil fuel lending, the single largest lender in development terms. So you've got these two bodies that are the primary motors of this movement towards private sector lending away from public sector lending. Now I think there are essentially three reasons behind this ongoing transition. The first of which is the desire of donor countries to leverage public funds into more effective aid to capitalize on scarce resources, and that's why we're going to see more of this, because resources are becoming a lot more scarce. But there's also, I think, two more kind of fundamental reasons. The first one of which is that there's a more overt use of multilateral development lending for particular political interests by donor countries. For example, the European Union is engaged in what can really only be described as an energy grab, as the investment in a series of very large energy infrastructure projects that are directly bringing natural gas and oil and electricity from Central Asia, North and Central Africa, all the way to Europe on huge infrastructure projects. And a lot of those are being supported, or if they come to fruition, will be supported by development lending. So that's sort of a much more overt attempt by the EU to guarantee energy security. There's also a similar process going on in terms of the expansion of the EU's raw materials agenda. So you've got a more overt interest in donor countries in accessing their own needs. And the third of which is that this is the culmination of 30 years of ideology, in a way. This is the product of what the World Bank has been doing for the last 30 years. If we look at all throughout the 90s, the World Bank systematically reduced its lending to public infrastructure in preparation for privatization, deregulation, liberalization, and therefore the support of private firms. So a lot of the public infrastructure that could have been lent to by development banks in the 80s or early 90s either no longer exists or has been privatized out of the public interest. So in a way, this is a self-fulfilling prophecy. It's a tautology that as a result of the move to the private as the answer, there is more and more, fewer and fewer options to invest in the public and more momentum towards this private sector turn. So this is something we're only going to see more of. But something that's been distinctive about this more gradual transition in the last 2 or 3 years has been the forms it's been taking. And it's been taking particularly two forms we're going to investigate more this afternoon after this morning's session, which is more generally about this transition, which is the form of financial intermediaries and of private equity lending. And those in IFC and EBRD and EIB terms are very, very apparent. 50% of IFC's lending last year was to the financial sector. And 75% of EIB's investment facility portfolio in Africa, which is a solely private sector lending facility, the main way that they lend in Africa, was last year either in private equity or in intermediary lending. So we're moving away, not just away from lending from countries to companies, We're also moving now away from lending to projects and more to these intermediated forms of finance, either through equity firms or through intermediary banks. So in a sense, we're retreating away from the concrete and into these more abstract realms. And that has a lot of really important implications. Primary among those, of course, is control. It's much harder, in a way, for the multilateral development agencies themselves to control the outcomes of the lending if it's going through these intermediary phases. It's harder for the donor countries, and it's harder for affected people. And it also means for us as activists, if we are, some of us are activists, some of us less so, if we are traditionally used to working on a project finance-based approach where the project is delimited, the impact is specific, the affected community is readily identified, and instead we're working through these intermediary forms where the effects are spread through several layers of less accountable, less trackable intermediary agencies, or they're going through private equity funds or funds of funds that are not just project specific. That means, I think, a fairly radical reconfiguration of how we approach our work. It also means that there's a big issue about transparency and accountability. How do you follow this development lending and its effects, and therefore on development effectiveness? What are the criteria that these institutions who are now in control of development finance in a way, intermediary banks or private equity funds, how do their interests correlate with the interests of developing countries, and how, as NGOs interested in this work, do we try and enforce a development effectiveness agenda? In a way, I don't think we should be surprised by this, because if you look at what has been the motor of economic development for the last 30 years, it's essentially been the private sector's takeover of public interests. I mean, in this country, we've seen the nationalization of key industries, the prioritization of key industries. We've seen the privatization of transport. We've seen the privatization of health and of education. So in a sense, development is just next in the paradigm. And I think in some ways that's very helpful. I think there's a strong tendency among people who work in the development field to regard development capitalism as somehow a separate or detached form of capitalism from a lot of the things that happen domestically, and that is simply isn't the case. And if we start to think about what is the role of the private sector in development, then it allows us to go back to question some of our most fundamental assumptions. It's quite noticeable that whenever you go to meetings or conferences or read something, the essential prerequisite is you have to have the private sector involved in development in order to generate economic growth. And this, I think, provides us a really good opportunity to question that. Not only what form of private sector involvement is beneficial for people in poor countries, not only what are the distributional impacts of economic growth, so you may have growth in a country, but if it's concentrated in one particular sector or whatever, then there may not be a wider beneficial impact, but also, at what point do the legitimate interests of private capital not only not coincide with those of people in developing countries or developing governments, but are actually antithetical to it? At what point is the private sector antithetical to development as well as a potential driver of it? So those, I think, are some of the bigger and more interesting implications of what we're going to get to today. We're going to start with a panel that essentially confronts these issues as larger issues, looking at this generalized turn to the private sector, what that might imply, with some specific institutional focus. And then this afternoon, we're going to look more carefully at those two more recent fields of private sector growth, which is the issue of financial intermediaries and of private equity.